replace Jason.
Yeah.
You don't do holidays.
He's off on a beach somewhere, I think.
Welcome to the Swifty Podcast, a conversation about inspiring positive change through design, innovation, and technology.
Hi, welcome to the Swifty Podcast. Today we have a special guest. This is Sara Tomkins,
Hello.
CEO of GreaterSport. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming down.
Oh, pleasure to be here at Swifty. It's fantastic.
So, I've invited Sara here today because the work she's doing is really important to Manchester specifically. So I think let's hear from her what GreaterSport is and what it's all about.
Okay, GreaterSport is a charity. We work on behalf of Greater Manchester with people like Sport England and the Mayor of Manchester and our health and social care partnership to improve the health outcomes of our population, which is a fantastic mission we've got. But our lens on that mission is really about encouraging people to move more using physical activity or just generally walking and getting out and about more to improve the health and fitness of our population.
So even though it's called GreaterSport, it's not actually sport, is it?
No, it's not.
Is it a bit sport?
It's a little bit sport. If it's about encouraging people to try maybe new sports or give sport a go, or if they haven't done sport for a long time, because a lot of people remember sport fondly, but they forget or get out the habit. So we still sometimes encourage the use of sport, but on the whole, it's just encouraging people to fit everyday movement back into their lives. I think, you know, we talk about how we design movement out of our lives. You know, everything we do now is for convenience, and that stops
us moving. Lazy.
I don't think people are lazy. I don't. I just think, well, actually, we've probably all inbuilt to be efficient and to save time and to find ways of cutting corners. I don't think it's pure laziness. I think the way the world works around us doesn't help us to actually physically move and build that into the day. So, you know, if you see an escalator or a lift, it's almost like your brain programs itself to go up there or press the button rather than look for the stairs or find that actually healthier way of getting from A to B. We just go with the flow.
Modern life is time pressure. Pressurised, isn't it?
You know, it's really hard trying to juggle everything together and fit your busy lives in. Yeah. And if you can find a shortcut, I think naturally we all program to do that option instead. So how do we culturally reprogram ourselves to think about movement as a positive rather than a negative? Now, I always use the example of everybody fights to park nearest to the entrance to the supermarket or whatever, or to, you know, the school run, you drop your kids off at the closest point. When actually, if you said, right, I'm going to park the furthest away and that gives me, you know, a few more minutes of movement and see that as a positive thing rather than a pain or it's a, you know, it's an inconvenience. You know, it's actually turning the way you actually view it is something we're trying to do. And that's all about behaviour change and
social. So how do you approach that? How do you reach these target groups, people who are inactive?
Well, it's something everybody always says, it's really hard to reach certain audiences when it's not really. It's just about really understanding your audience and knowing who you're talking to and how to best then engage the conversation at the right time. So we often work with people like health providers. So GPs are a fantastic source of support for the work that we do. So they will often engage the conversation with patients who come in probably for a condition that can be helped by movement, or they come in because they're feeling socially isolated, or they might have anxiety levels. They come in for a prescription or a medical advice and some support, and at that point that's when it's a great opportunity for a doctor to start talking about the power of the miracle drug, as we call it, which is movement, and just trying to fit more of that into the day-to-day lives to ease conditions.
So this social prescribing, how does that work now? Are doctors actually doing that actively now?
It's growing really fast, actually. We're not as much as we'd like. We're on a big mission this year to increase the numbers, but we've got about 300 GP practices across Greater Manchester socially prescribing.
300?
Yeah,
wow.
Which is fantastic,
and
isn't it?
Is that work that you've been doing specifically?
Mostly through the health and social care partnership, but I suppose physical activity is one of the things on the prescription list as an alternative to a drug. So there's a fantastic example of a practice called Alvany in Stockport. They actually have a prescription pad with alternatives to medicine. So it might be a singing class, which is really good for helping you breathe if you've got COPD, or it might be a health walk. They have an allotment. You know, a GP practice has invested in some land and have built an allotment so they can encourage people to go and dig and garden and socially interact in a different way. So they're now socially prescribing opportunities to move or be engaged in community social activities, and that can help a lot of people with different conditions if they're feeling a bit low, a bit lonely. Maybe they've had a heart attack, or maybe they've lost their wife,
and you know, have
really big effects. Life-changing issues that people are going to the doctors to talk to about, and they might still need medical help, but this on top of that can change, you know, help with other conditions that might build up if they're feeling poorly.
What, is that actually working now? I mean, is there data back?
Progress. The two key issues with social prescribing is scalability and also data collection and evidence, because it's really hard. A lot of social prescribing is done by volunteers, and the last thing a volunteer is wants to count numbers every time they do a health walk, or you know, how many hours have they spent on the allotment. You know, this is data that for them doesn't feel massively important, because they know the good that they're doing and the work is changing lives. We're trying to help find simple ways and better ways of measuring that in more creative ways.
Is there any technology coming out to help that?
They're using sort of
Fitbits and things.
Do you know, it's quite lo-fi, and I like the fact it's quite lo-fi. I think if you go too high tech, especially with some of the customers we're dealing with, I think you might put people off just taking part. I love the fact it's a piece of paper, like you'd get in the doctor's, a prescription for your drugs. It's a prescription to say, join the health walk on Tuesday, 12 o'clock, you know, go and go down to the allotment and do a bit of a dig around and just meet some people and get engaged in that. I think I like the fact it's just what you'd expect a doctor to give you, but in that kind of traditional sense. But at the same time, in terms of measurements, I was speaking to the general practice manager, Kate, the other day, and she was saying that normally GPs are really time starved with each patient. They have about 10 minutes. Because of the work they've been doing with social prescribing, they can now increase the conversation time that they have with patients to 15 minutes, because they've actually reduced the demand coming through the GP's front door of the social prescribing. And they're doing it fantastic well. So they have got to a point where it's scalable within that practice, within that community. I was chatting to one of the guys who does the social prescribing, and he said the doctor was running late. He managed to speak to the patient before they went into the GP, talked to them. They were having issues with low level sort of stress and anxiety, depression. They were going through a lot of tough times with financial debt and management. And he just talked to them a little bit about how he could help. He's a social prescribe officer supporting people in difficult times. So he was helping them with the debt and the issues, and then prescribed a few social things like going on these walks or being involved in these groups. And then when it came to see the GP, he walked into the GP and said, actually, I don't need to see you anymore, because I'm going to do all of that first before I take a pill, because I'd rather. And I think most people would rather find better solutions than drugs to solve problems. But sometimes they just need a bit of guide and helping hands. So it's starting to work, and hopefully we'll see more and more of it happen as we see the NHS respond to their new plans and their new 10-year strategy.
Is this part of the Manchester pilot that I've heard about?
Yeah, well, I think Manchester's got health devolution, so that's quite unusual. Nowhere else in the country has the devolved powers from the NHS. We still work with the NHS, but we have a devolved set of powers where we can actually try and do different things. Yeah, Greater Manchester has those devolved powers, which is something we did a couple of years ago as part of our kind of devolved conversations with government about how we want to do things differently on the ground. You know, the NHS is a fantastic, amazing institution, but to understand local level problems and how we can change demand at a GP's front door, we've been given just some opportunities to try and test a few things a bit differently. So devolved health is one way that I think we're starting to see some changes of innovation.
Might this roll out nationally?
I think some of the ideas of what we do, but also other pockets of great examples of doing things differently with health from around the country are shaping the way that we need to think differently about the NHS. And that's driving new policies and new procedures of how we think about everything's about sort of hospital wait times, and you know, it's all about that end issue. You get that poorly, you end up in A&E, or you get that poorly, you need an operation, and that's where the pressure is. But all of that can be stemmed and kind of managed better right from the heart of the community and the GP who sits in the community. But also family, social environment makes a huge difference on your health. So we need to start really at a place level with communities, with streets, you know, in places like Greater Manchester, we can have those conversations.
Sure. Because nationally, there's a problem with obesity, diabetes,
mental health,
cardiovascular, all those things.
Yeah.
And physical activity kind of reaches a whole breadth of problems.
It's amazing for musculoskeletal, for diabetes type 2, for cancer, reducing stress and anxiety for certain cancers, supports cardiovascular, COPD, we talked about breathing difficulties earlier. Physical activity is literally can reverse some of those symptoms or prevent those symptoms from getting worse or prevent them happening in the first place. If people just did 30 minutes of movement, and that's not getting lycra on and running around in the gym and pumping iron and being super fit, it's just about getting your heart rate up and feeling a bit sweaty,
that's
which is
super important.
Things like scooting is a massive part of what we're trying to encourage people to think differently about how they fit movement into their day. Yeah. So how they walk to school or scoot to school with the kids, how they get off the bus to stop earlier, how they take the stairs, not the lift, how people park that bit further away or don't use a car at all. Active travel is, you know, a massively important part of everybody's day-to-day. If you can just switch the modes in how you commute, then hopefully we can see some changes in health. So that's one part of the conversation we're having.
So also in Manchester, we've got a walking and cycling commissioner.
Chris Boardman. We're very lucky.
So he's crazy about active travel, and that one statistic he keeps repeating, and that is that 30% of all car journeys are less than a mile.
Yes. So
that's like...
Yeah, and a lot of that is down to sort of the school run or just popping to the shop or, you know, driving to the office, when actually it could just be done on foot. You know, we've spoken to people from Great Manchester about the barriers to movement and all those things. You know, the weather doesn't help, but actually there's no such thing as a bad weather day, is there? It's just bad clothing. You've just got to think about how you get about the city in a different way. So the work we're doing with schools at the moment is thinking about those nudges to encourage parents to think differently about it. So We're talking with Transport for Greater Manchester and some schools around how they have a time-limited road closure in front of their school.
Okay.
So it stops cars getting to the front gate. So it makes it a little bit more inconvenient, as we were talking about earlier, and also pushes the cars away. And that, and not just the cars, the air pollution, which is not good for our kids at all.
Right,
so we're
seeing
a lot of issues with asthma and breathing difficulties because of the pollution. And I think the air quality agenda around schools is gaining momentum. I think that's a much more powerful argument to frame with schools and also with parents around nobody wants to be causing damage to young children
and
affecting them for the rest
everybody.
Of their life. Yeah.
That's not just the person who...
Well, it's actually worse if you're in the car. You know, the pollution coming into the car is equally as bad. And also little people, because they're at this level, are breathing in more of it than we are as adults.
And they're still growing, aren't they?
Yeah, and their lungs are still in development. So, you know, they're big issues. And we're seeing the impact of the asthma levels in Greater Manchester, the long-term issues that will create for breathing conditions in later life. So we need to think about how we push the cars away from our young people. And I think if we do that, we might stop some of those one-mile nipping in journeys and encourage parents to think about how they do it differently. And encourage schools as well to play their part in encouraging that, because, you know, some people might say, oh, I'd love to scoot in with my kids, but the kids can't leave their scooters in school, so then I have to carry a scooter home with me. And how do we change some of those really simple things that might make huge differences to how people think about getting from A to B?
Yeah, because I think I met a guy in London who runs the bikeability course in schools. So schools still have like cycling proficiency.
I remember it's cycling proficiency, but
bikeability
sounds much cooler, doesn't it?
But actually, he was based in London. He said not one school he goes to does bikeability anymore. They've changed it to scootability because the parents in London won't let kids cycle in London.
Yeah.
Mm. And when there's statistics around cycling and walking, we can see that 1% of kids cycle to school, which is nothing compared to the Netherlands, which is 50% of kids. cycling to school, you can see, well, actually, it's because of there's no space for kids to cycle mm-hmm. safely.
Yeah.
And they're either scooting or using the bus
mm-hmm.
or getting driven.
Yeah.
So,
and I think scooting is a really good way of getting kids safely into school. And I think Chris Boardman would agree that currently cycling isn't as safe as we'd like it to be. And his mission with spending millions of pounds, which they're investing here in Greater Manchester, which is fantastic, is about safe cycleways. So that,
and it's changed loads since he's been around.
And all the cycleways are starting to be built now. You're seeing segregated cycleways as well. So they are segregated from the traffic, which makes you feel much safer. I'm a cyclist, so I know how it feels when you're, as an adult,
the
sort of driving, cycling around.
Shared paths as well. They're really effective.
Yeah, they're working well, I think. And his mission is to make it safe for a seven-year-old to cycle. And cycle around Greater Manchester. So I agree with your point that currently it doesn't feel safe. So
I have a seven-year-old. We barely get out on the bikes.
Yeah, yeah.
We do have bikes and scooters. but going on a bike ride is quite a rare thing. Mm. Scooting is a day-to-day thing.
Yes. Yeah. And I think for short journeys as well, like a nice bike ride is great, isn't it, with a family, and you can go for a little longer.
Yeah.
But I think quick nipping in and out of school run and, you know, to the shops and back, scooting is a perfect
option. Shorten a 1 mile school run to like 10 minutes.
And it's so much better for you than walking. Although we love walking and we promote walking as much as anything, you know, scooting does raise the heart rate a little bit further. You know, you are using different muscle groups, so you're pushing. I think it's good for balance for kids and adults because we all lose our balance as our muscles as we age. So, really important.
But you have to scoot with both legs. You have to swap legs.
Well, I have to. I can't scoot on one leg. It hurts too much. I have to keep switching my legs. I'm not fit enough.
But you can train your brain to get better at scooting on your, you know, less dominant side, can't you?
I think it's
that, again,
practice.
Like, helps, like, build those neural links to,
that, you know, little nudge,
improve your balance in general.
We do a lot at the older end with trips and falls, because a big issue with our muscle wastage as we get older is the fact that we fall over more, because our muscles are wasting naturally with age. That just happens. You can be a super fit person and your muscles will waste. So how you use lifting and weights and yoga and Pilates and stuff to strengthen your muscles is really important. But, you know, scooting for any age is fabulous for that, kind of building the muscles back up in the body.
Loads of customers who are retired, senior age.
Yeah, well, that's great.
Loads of cool, active grandmas and things.
Yeah, it's great fun.
So love hearing back from them.
As you get older, you don't lose your sense of fun, do you? So I think it's really important that people feel confident to be able to scoot all the time, whatever age. And the health benefits are, you know, there to see. So
you've got is it called Active Aging, your little campaign around that?
Yeah, it's fantastic.
And I remember you mentioning how, even though you say 30 minutes of exercise, that can include strength
and balance as
strength
well,
and balance,
as we call it in our technical world. So, but yeah, it's just basically, you know, might be some standing on one leg, or, you know, some thinking about some weights, but not talking like huge, like iron, you know, although some grannies can probably lift way more than I can, but, you know, baked bean cans, just carrying their shopping home, you know, that's good for them in terms of that kind of just strengthening their muscles at all time. And yoga, Pilates is really good. But weights are fantastic. Anything that can kind of just push your muscles against.
My press-up technique against the kitchen. Jason thinks it's hilarious.
It's the simple
thing. It's really good.
Well, squatting while you're cleaning your teeth, you know, all of those things, little tiny little nudges all the time. Well, I'm glad you're doing daft things at home as well, because I do as well. So it's finding those moments, isn't it, where you can squeeze in a little bit of time. I think, dancing around the kitchen while you're cooking. Or so, you know, it's just, how do you keep moving all the time rather than just sit still and,
Moving swiftly on.
Nice.
GreaterSport is an owner of a nice scooter fleet.
Mm-hmm.
Three Swifties you have.
We do.
So I want you to explain a little bit about why you've invested in a fleet of scooters for your staff.
We're only a small team, so there's about 30 of us. We felt three scooters initially would be a good starting point to just see if they get used, if people enjoy them, how often they get used, and also if they help people get to and from the meetings that we have to do. So we're based out near Manchester City's football ground. So we scoot over to meetings in the cycling centre or into town, or we take the scooters out on meetings and scoot into meetings with them. So they make a statement, actually. Obviously, we're all about encouraging people to move. So walking into an office or a meeting room with your scooter is a really good statement about how active travel can be achieved on different forms of transport as well. So they make a statement. I think they're a good talking point, but actually, more importantly, the staff love them. They really enjoy scooting. And it's not just about getting to and from meetings. It's about lunchtime. They can scoot to Asda and get a supermarket shopping or get a sandwich
That's
or whatever.
So good to hear.
And Eddie, who's our finance manager.
Thought you might mention Eddie.
Oh, I love Eddie, but we can't get him to like he's, you know, in front of his desk all the time. He's doing his numbers. He's really good at balancing the books and making sure we're all, you know, making sure we've got the money coming in and out and we're all okay. But he doesn't often do the daily mile, go for a walk with us at lunchtime, or he doesn't necessarily join in some of the classes that we have on. But he'll just pick up the scooter on his own and go for a little scoot around the Etihad and just have a 5-minute break from his screen and come back in and feel much better. And you can see him physically feel like energized from the whole process.
Yeah.
So table tennis, I've never seen him active other than on the scooter. So it works for people that you don't expect it's going to work for as well. So it's not just all the fit active ones who are jumping on them. They do initially, but then actually you find, you know, I was working with Ellen Effa, she'd never been on a scooter before and she was a bit nervous and we went on one together and she loved it as well. So I think it just brings out the big kids, brings out people who don't necessarily feel comfortable going to aerobics or squash or anything formal like that because it's not their thing. But yeah, it's just a fun way of getting
aerobics
about.
And things can be so intimidating.
Yeah,
it's certainly not for everybody.
Some people love their circuits and they love being beasted around and being told to, you know, jump up and down. But it isn't for everybody, and it's not the only way you can get your exercise in.
And would you, you know, why did you pick a scooter fleet rather than bikes, for example?
Well, a lot of people sort of use bikes to get in and out of work anyway, and there's a bit of a bike store, so we've got bikes covered, I think. I think the scooters are just easy to have in the office. They're for people who might have biked in but don't necessarily want to bike to the city centre and have to worry about parking a bike, because you can take them into the meeting room, so you don't have to think about safety and security and parking and all of that stuff. So, and they're just like easy to just nip in and out, and it's quite social as well. You don't often get, Eddie will go off and scoot around on his own, but most of people will go together. So who fancies a scoot to the shops, or who's going, you know, you go into meetings together. So people scoot together. So they're a little bit more sociable because you can chat whilst you're scooting.
Because they're a little bit slower, aren't they?
Yeah, a little bit. So, well, it depends on how hilly it is if you can chat, because I'm certainly not so good going up the hills on the scooter. But yeah, you can, you know, they're going at a pace and you can go faster or slower depending on how much time you've got and whether you want to do it more leisurely. So I think they're fun. I think they encourage you to have a chat and enjoy yourself as you're going along and, yeah, open up conversations in different
ways.
And
we've customised them for you.
Yes, they're covered in our brand, so they look really cool.
A beautiful purple shade.
Yay! We've got purpley pinky shades.
Great sport all over them.
Yeah. So they, you know, they're, I think
so
they represent
smart,
what we
they?
Stand for, which is really great. And it's an important symbol, but they're not just sat in the office. They are used, and that's nice to see. So
great. We mentioned we are running a crowdfunding campaign on Cedars, and we're talking about our new app that we've been working on. So as a fleet owner, what do you think of that idea?
I think it's great, because although I can see they're being used, you know, I'm a small office and we've got a small number of people. I think if you're a bigger company and you're going to invest in something like this, you want to be able to see a return on investment. You want to see that that has given you value. So to be able to actually have a bit of an app and you can see who's using them, how often they're getting used, how many miles they've done, you know, so you can just track the performance of how
and
well they're being received.
Seeing where they're going.
Seeing where they're going.
Just someone goes...
Yeah, I suppose. Well, I'm lucky. I work with a great team, so I don't have to worry too much about that. But I think, the bigger you get, or, you know, if you're in a corporate organisation, or if you're using them, say if you're a landowner and you own a big plot of land and you've got several tenants, I suppose you want to be able to track who's picked them up, and so you can track where they've gone and who's had them last. And you might need those extra bits of security.
Are there any features on there that you, other than those things you've listed, that you'd quite like? Maybe a bit of a feedback for
knowing our place, because we get competitive over everything. Sure there'll be want to be a leaderboard of who scooted the most.
Oh, a leaderboard.
Yeah, definitely. Good, something about how idea. Many how many sort of minutes you've spent, yeah. or how far you've
some
gone.
Some sort of incentive.
How fast, yeah, yeah.
Some they'll sort of incentives and yeah. gamify it a little bit.
Yeah, that always seems to work well for us. Mm. But you know, it gets the people kind of in a more competitive mode. But I think just tracking how well they're being used, and so you can see for the investment you've spent on bringing them in. I mean, we've incorporated scooting to meetings as part of our mileage claim. So if somebody goes to a meeting, obviously in a corporate environment, you'll claim your mileage back if you drive, you'll claim your parking back, or your public transport costs. So I know some organisations have done bike mileage, and we've included scooter in the same thing. So if you scoot or bike to a meeting, we pay you 20p a mile, or I think it is, I'll have to check. But yeah, something like that. So instead of for me, it would be more expensive if they use public transport.
Wow,
if
so you're actually paying your
paying
staff
to scoot. Yeah, to scoot. Meeting. Yeah, so they get a personal incentive, really, to drive the behaviour, to say, if you're active, that's good for me as an employer, that's good for you as a person, and it's good that you're showing and demonstrating how active travel can be fitted into everyday life. So yeah.
That's such a good example of how to, you know, really motivate staff to, you know, be more active. And then
I think it's important.
There's so much evidence about how much more, you know, how they get on better with the work and their concentration.
The science is there. So if any employer is thinking this is a nice thing to do, there's an underlying science about productivity. So if people are sat down all day, your body starts to shut down, your cells shut down, your brain starts to shut down. So you're not creative, you're not as productive, and you're not literally working as efficiently and effectively as you can. So if you can encourage your staff to get up, move around at lunchtime, go for a scoot, go for a walk, you will see improved productivity.
That 20p.
Yeah, let alone the mental health benefits of movement which I think you've got to, you know, the world we work in now is very stressful, and you get much more mental health issues, I think, in employment nowadays than ever before, because the pressure's on like you haven't seen. So, and also that screen time and the amount of sedentary time that we have, breaking some of that up is really, really important for employers for productivity gains, absenteeism improvements. So we're doing lots of experiments at the moment in Manchester with some big employers on just encouraging them to do at least a 15-minute walk at lunchtime, get people away from their desks, away from the screens, and see what productivity level looks like in the afternoon compared to people who don't move.
Wow.
And see how they perform. But creatively, your brain fires up and you can think clearer, you can think more creatively, more innovative. So, you know, it's really important that you see and understand the science of
movement. And it's really easy to recognise in yourself, isn't it? Because I've scooted to meetings and felt totally sparky, you know, at the meeting. Whereas if I'm just sitting around here all day at my desk, then it's different. I better get some more cups of tea going around.
Yeah, you start wanting the sugar
you
hit
rely
in the afternoon,
on the caffeine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So this is a great alternative, much healthier for everybody. So
you're setting such a good example, and I hope it's rubbing off on everyone around us.
We're trying. But it's not just about us setting an example. I think the mayor, Andy Burnham, fantastic mayor here in Greater Manchester, who really understands the value of sport and health, he's just launched a Greater Manchester Good Employment Charter. And the 7 points around what he's looking for all employers in Greater Manchester to demonstrate. So from living wage to looking at how you support inequalities in the workplace and look at things like how you develop your staff and invest in your staff. But one of the themes is around workplace wellness and workplace health. And so we're plugged right into that and encouraging and talking to businesses about how they can improve their workplace productivity and the health and well-being of their staff. So we're working with big organisations, small organisations, third sector organisations to encourage them to think about how they, as employers, have a responsibility. Sure. And now this is hardwired into the employment charter and some organisations, Manchester City Council, one of them is said that they potentially won't do business with you. You won't be able to procure through them if you don't have the charter and you're not sort of adhering to the things that make you a good business, which is, for us, it makes business sense to think about the health and well-being of your employees for your absenteeism and productivity. But this actually structures it into a conversation around, you know, you need to be good employers and you need to treat your staff well. Otherwise, you might not be able to procure with certain organisations in the city. So it's really putting a bit of teeth into the conversation about it's your responsibility, but actually you need to have this if you want to do business.
Wow, that's quite a big step,
powerful.
Isn't it? That is powerful.
Yeah, it's
and
really powerful.
It's bound to have an effect immediately, really, if they can implement that.
And staff, I think, will benefit from that. I think every employer will feel the benefits of living wage, but also being treated and looked after, and their employers caring about the health and well-being of their staff, and thinking about how physical activity can improve some of the conditions that people might be struggling with on a day-to-day basis. So,
a lot of it's about awareness, isn't it? Like how important it is, and just educating people on the statistics and the evidence and the science behind it all. Because it's all well and good, people like me saying, scooting's great, you'll feel really good, you'll get fitter and everything. Yeah. But having the science is really important. I think that's where our app can come in a little bit. Mm. So provide data to employers around the use of the fleets. Mm. And hopefully that'll all tie into what you guys are doing and what Andy Burnham's doing. So let's see.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think that's it. Thank you very much, Sara Tomkins from GreaterSport.
My pleasure.
See you next time.